The final category of macromolecules we'll discuss are the lipids. The final category of macromolecules we'll discuss are the lipids. Lipids contain one or more fatty acids. These fatty acids are very hydrophobic. They do not want to mix with water or other polar molecules. Fatty acids are long chains of carbon and hydrogen atoms. These two types of atoms will form nonpolar covalent bonds with each other. So when you have long chains of carbon and hydrogen atoms, they will not have this uneven tug of war that carbon and hydrogen will have with some other atoms like oxygen or nitrogen. There are a few different categories of fatty acids. Now, some of these terms you may be familiar with and have heard before, yet some might be new. The first of these types of fatty acids are known as saturated fatty acids. They are said to be saturated because they have the maximum number of hydrogen atoms covalently bonded to the carbons. It also means that along this carbon chain, nowhere in that chain is there a carbon-carbon double bond. And so, because of this, the molecule is very straight or linear. Saturated fats are more likely to be solid at room temperature because they can stack very closely together. So animal fats and butter are very common examples of saturated fats. On the other hand, unsaturated fats will have a carbon-carbon double bond somewhere along the length of that fatty acid. Because there is a carbon-carbon double bond, there is less than the maximum number of hydrogens, and that's why this molecule is called unsaturated. Now, unsaturated fatty acids are more likely to be liquid at room temperature. These are going to be our oils, like olive oil or vegetable oil or soybean oil. Unsaturated fatty acids are not going to stack as closely together because they have these bends or kinks in them. And so for that reason, the molecules don't stack as closely, and they're going to be liquid at room temperature. Now you may be wondering, well, what are trans fats? You may have heard recently about trans fats and how they are harmful to cardiovascular health. So what are trans fats? Well, trans fats are fats that had been unsaturated, but then through chemical processing, the bend has been straightened. Now, a trans fat still has a carbon-carbon double bond, but because the double bond has been straightened or made linear, these molecules are more likely to be solid at room temperature. They are likely to have a texture that is thicker than that of an unsaturated fat. So trans fats, they don't actually exist in nature. This is an example of humans taking unsaturated fats, which are naturally occurring, and processing them to now give them new properties or new traits. Now, there are some things that trans fats are very helpful or beneficial in, such as giving texture to frosting or coffee cream or a variety of other things. If you've ever seen on an ingredients label partially hydrogenated oil, that is a trans fat. In fact, margarine is also an example of trans fats. While trans fats have fewer calories than saturated fats, trans fats do negatively impact cholesterol levels. Within the body. So here we see margarine as an example of a trans fat, and where there's still a carbon-carbon double bond, but that bond has been made linear. It is in its trans orientation instead of its cis orientation, and that is why this molecule is called a trans fat. Now, it is possible for us to take an unsaturated fat and fully bring it to saturated status. That's the case with vegetable shortening, or Crisco. This had been an unsaturated fat that through the process of hydrogenation, or chemical processing, we've now made it fully saturated. In our diet, we consume both fats and oils, which are actually both a particular type of lipid. Fats are normally solid at room temperature and composed primarily of saturated fats, where oils are normally liquid at room temperature and include unsaturated fats. Now, it turns out that both fats and oils are triglycerides. So what are triglycerides? Well, as its name suggests, triglycerides, they have three fatty acid chains covalently bonded to a glycerol molecule. Now, triglycerides play very important roles for energy storage reserves, both in the bodies of humans and in other organisms. These three fatty acid chains are linked to the glycerol molecule through covalent bonds, and the formation of those covalent bonds occurs via dehydration synthesis, just like the assembly and formation of the other types of macromolecules. Now, unlike the carbohydrates and the proteins and the nucleic acids, lipids aren't typically made of a long chain of monomers connected one to another over and over again. But there are these building blocks, these fatty acid chains, that do get connected to form larger molecules when they're attached to something like a glycerol molecule. Here we see a diagram of a triglyceride. This triglyceride has three fatty acid chains. Now, one thing we might notice is that these three chains are all very straight. There's no carbon-carbon double bond anywhere within these fatty acid chains. And so that tells us that this triglyceride is composed of saturated fatty acids. And so this would likely be solid at room temperature. In fact, stearic acid is a primary component of butter. Now, not all lipids are triglycerides. There's another molecule known as a phospholipid. Phospholipids are similar to triglycerides in some ways, but in some ways are very different. Phospholipids have two fatty acid chains connected to the glycerol, but in place of that third fatty acid chain, instead there is a phosphate group. The significance of this is that phosphates are very hydrophilic, whereas fatty acid chains are very hydrophobic. So here we have another one of those molecules which is going to be polar on one end and nonpolar on the other. The head of the molecule where the phosphate is found is very hydrophilic, whereas the tails of the molecules, these two fatty acid chains, are very hydrophobic. Phospholipids, they end up making a major component of plasma membranes. The final type of lipid I would like to talk about are ring lipids. Some fatty acid chains will form ring structures, for example, cholesterol. Cholesterol is often given a bad reputation because it does have negative impacts on the blood vessels within our body. It can cause obstructions that could lead to increased risks of heart attack and stroke. But it turns out that cholesterol is also essential for our body. We could not survive without cholesterol. And another function that cholesterol plays is that cholesterol is the base steroid hormone. All other steroid hormones, including testosterone and estrogen and progesterone, they are all formed by taking cholesterol and chemically modifying it slightly. adding a group here, removing a group there, changing a bonding pattern. But this one molecule, cholesterol, can be modified in many different ways to give us our various steroid hormones. So with that, we have discussed the four major macromolecules that make up living cells. Now that we've talked about those structures, we can talk a bit about cells and how cells function and what role these macromolecules play in the functioning of those cells.